guys tonight. And as you can probably imagine, Bob asked me to talk about a whole bunch of stuff. And we're good. Okay. So my talk tonight is going to cover several areas, but it's primarily going to focus on the relationship between diet and health. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get started. By over 80% in the last 10 years alone. Thank you, Dunkin' Donuts and Krispy Kreme. This avalanche of diabetes and chronic disease has affected people of all races and has been fueled in part by the corruption and homogenization of American eating habits by giant fast and snack food corporations. It used to be you went to the gas station to get gas. Now you get gas and many hot dogs and tacos and God knows what else. We've seen the proliferation of fast food restaurants in poor neighborhoods. Studies have shown that they're actually targeted to poor neighborhoods and have put unhealthy foods within easy reach of everyone. And these are coupled with marketing campaigns that encourage people to overindulge on the slightest whim. It's, you know, it's all about just eating. And someone earlier today talked about the fact that there have been statistics that suggest that people are eating less meat and animal food on a per capita basis or on an aggregate basis. But what is happening is that I think it is true that individuals are eating less meat, but individuals are also eating more meat, because it used to be that, you know, you'd get a pizza and the pizza would be crust and some cheese and whatever else. Now they got cheese in the crust, they got cheese around the crust, and one unfortunate group has even put bacon on the around the cheese in the crust. It's just And so what these companies are doing is that because people are eating less meat as individuals, they're trying to get each individual who continues to eat meat and animal food to eat more of it. Is it any wonder we have a major health crisis in this country? The damaging and the destructive effects of chronic diseases are actually amplified in communities of color and among racial and ethnic minorities, where these diseases reach disproportionate levels and cause complication rates that are well above the national average. As it turns out, if an African American is diagnosed with diabetes, and let me just say parenthetically that African American men are more than 10 times as likely to develop diabetes as Caucasian men, African American women are more than 7 times as likely, and we'll talk about some of the reasons for this increased risk in a minute. But the unfortunate thing is that once an African American is diagnosed with diabetes, that person is more than 100 times more likely to end up with kidney failure, on dialysis, to end up blind due to retinal damage, and over 240 times more likely to end up with a limb amputation than his or her Caucasian counterpart. Now this, as you can imagine, has a devastating economic impact upon people of color, because frequently these diseases strike the primary wage earner in the home. And so whereas before you had someone who went to work every day trying to earn money to help, you know, pay for education and move the family to, say, better neighborhoods, now what money that does come into the household is frequently tied up in trying to treat and manage this chronic disease. So these diseases have a very, very devastating impact on communities of color. And of course, if the primary wage earner dies, then suddenly the family finds itself plunged back into poverty and has very few ways of getting out. Well, as you know, New World and European blacks are descendants of African peoples who were originally taken from Western Africa. And these are the countries from which blacks were essentially stolen during the slave trade. Traditional West African diets are actually plant-based diets centered around green, leafy, and root vegetables, whole grains, fruits, legumes, and contain no dairy foods. These diets are typically low in fat, involving high in fiber, antioxidants, and a variety of phytochemicals. These traditional diets usually contain very little animal food because these people don't eat meat at every meal. And when they do eat meat, they typically eat it in much smaller proportions than we see in Western countries. So instead of sitting down and having a whole chicken to themselves, that chicken will feed, you know, 6 or 7 people. These diets also tend to be very low in both saturated and total fat. Amongst West Africans adhering to traditional dietary patterns, Western-style chronic diseases are almost non-existent. Coronary artery disease or heart disease, diabetes, breast and prostate cancer, and colon cancers are very rare. Health problems like constipation, diverticulosis, and other ailments common in Western countries are also almost unheard of. So this brings up the whole concept of soul food. Now, when you look at what African Americans typically eat, the studies show that what African Americans eat are comparable to what everybody else is eating in terms of total calories, percentage of calories from fat, amount of protein. But we know that even though they are essentially eating what everybody else is eating, that these diets cause disproportionate levels of chronic disease. And this is due to something called thrifty genes. Thrifty gene complexes are metabolic genes governing our metabolism that, with in populations that traditionally adhere to plant-based diets, have basically adapted to that low-fat, dilute energy plant-based diet. When someone with these genes then starts to eat a Western-style diet, it promotes excess levels of disease in these groups. And this is not only true for African Americans, it's also true for Asians, Native Americans, and people from South America, South and Central America. Now, what this graph shows you is what's called glucose intolerance, or essentially pre-diabetes, and then the other side stands for non-insulin-dependent diabetes, or essentially adult-onset diabetes. Excuse me. And what you can see in green are blacks living in Europe and the United States versus blacks living in West Africa. Now, what did I just tell you about West African diets? That they're traditionally plant-based diets, low in fat, contain very little animal food, and no dairy. And look what happens in terms of your risk for developing diabetes if you adhere to that diet. It's very low to non-existent. But you come over to America and start chowing down at McDonald's and Burger King, and you're going to have anything but a happy day because your disease risk is going to go through the roof. And as you can see, compared to blacks living in West Africa, blacks living in Europe and in the world have much, much higher rates of diabetes and, by extension, other chronic disease. So-called soul food is actually peculiar to the African-American community. It includes things like chitlins, oxtails, neck bones, pig feet, and other high-fat, high-salt, and sugar-laden unhealthy foods. That last picture was a picture of cheese and macaroni, and I have a little funny story. I was talking to one of my patients in clinic one day about trying to eliminate the fat and meat from his diet, and I was talking about, you know, you can try to include pasta. He said, "Oh, Doc, I eat pasta." I'm like, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, I love macaroni and cheese." And I said, "Well, you know, macaroni and cheese is not really a low-fat food because, you know, cheddar cheese is very high in saturated fat and so on." And he said, "Oh, that's okay, Doc. I pour a little vinegar on it and that cuts fat." No, all that does is give you vinegar-flavored fat. So anyway, the Regards Health Study, which stands for Reasons for Geographic and Racial Differences in Stroke, this study examined the relationship between diet and stroke in over 30,000 black and white Americans age 45 years and older. And so this is a powerful study because it had a huge population, and it was powered to really make some very strong inferences or connections, excuse me, between what people were eating and the diseases they ultimately developed. And what this study showed was that most of the increased stroke risk seen in African-American can be explained by differences in dietary patterns. The study showed that the so-called Southern diet style, which featured heavy consumption of fried foods, organ meats, processed meats, full-fat milk, and sugar-sweetened drinks, while essentially eliminating intake of fruits, salads, and whole grains, increased stroke risk by 63%. Well, calling it the Southern diet style is just a polite way of calling it soul food. On the other hand, the plant-based dietary pattern, which included cruciferous vegetables, green leafy and other vegetables, fruits, beans, and whole grains, reduced stroke risk by more than 20%. So what I'd like to suggest to you is that this so-called soul food is not in fact soul food, it is plantation food. West Africans brought to America were forced to eat the literal garbage of the plantations of which they were enslaved. Now, I grant you, they showed ingenuity and resolve and took that garbage and did their best to transform it into something edible. But unfortunately, after African Americans were freed, we claimed what is essentially a dietary vestige of slavery and christened it soul food. These foods are not soul food, they are health-destroying plantation food. And they are not our true heritage, and we need to leave that crap back on the plantation. My mother tells me I always shouldn't say crap. Just some examples of the increased disease risk. This is a slide showing cardiovascular disease prevalence in various populations. As you can see, nobody's doing great, but the blacks are doing worse. This data is taken from American Heart Association, heart disease and stroke statistics from 2003. Epidemiology studies show that populations consuming a plant-based diet are at much lower risk of developing heart disease. Healthy plant-based diets benefit the heart by being low in total saturated fat, but high in heart-healthy fats like monounsaturated oils. These diets are also high in fiber, plant proteins, and antioxidants, contain little or no cholesterol. You get bonus points if you recognize my friend coming up here. Vegetarians and vegans typically have cardiovascular risk profiles well below those of omnivorous populations. They usually live longer, have lower body weights, lower blood pressure, lower levels of homocysteine, and have cholesterol levels that are 100 to 150 points below individuals we meet. Now, looking at high blood pressure, we know that it affects one out of every four Americans. It's often called the silent killer because people don't realize, if they don't go to their doctor, they don't realize their blood pressure is high until they either have a stroke or a heart attack. It increases the risk for heart disease, peripheral vascular disease, or hardening of the arteries in your legs and limbs, and for stroke. Turns out that stroke is the leading cause of disability in African American males between 25 and 55. And that's why I explain to my male patients, it's pretty hard to pull the ladies when you're dragging one half of your body and talking out the side of your mouth. So, need to get your blood pressure. Risk factors for hypertension include, of course, being overweight, a family history, excess drinking or alcohol intake, smoking will increase your blood pressure, excess sodium or salt, high fructose corn syrup, which unfortunately is in a lot of processed foods, which is why we need to cook and stay away from packaged foods, and diets that are high in animal and protein and fat also increase the risk for high blood pressure. Now, this is a study called DASH, or Dietary Approaches to Stop Hypertension. The study looked at switching people to a plant-based high vegetable and fruit diet and the impact it will have on blood pressure. And the basic thing I want you to notice is that in the dark blue are people without high blood pressure, in the light blue are individuals with blood pressure. And as you can see, for both black and white Americans, blacks who were diagnosed with high blood pressure switched to a plant-based diet, lowered their systolic blood pressure by almost 14 points. In the Caucasian Americans, it lowered it by about half that, around 7 points. And even in those without high blood pressure, it still lowered their systolic blood pressure, as well as lowering the diastolic blood pressure. This next study is a crossover trial. And this was a study where they took three groups of individuals. They put one on a typical standard American diet, meat-containing diet, and they stayed on that diet throughout the study period. But groups two and three, actually, at one point, well, let's look at group one. So, these are the people who stayed on the meat-containing diet, and you can see that basically, throughout period one and at the end of period two, their blood pressure was essentially unchanged. Now, group two, by contrast, was a group that was placed on a vegetarian, a plant-based diet, or it's actually a vegetarian diet, during period one. And as you can see, their blood pressure fell very nicely. But as they crossed over into period two, they went back to eating meat, and their blood pressure shot right back up. Group three, on the other hand, was on the meat-containing diet during period one, and then during period two, they crossed over and began eating the vegetarian diet, and you can see their blood pressure fell very, very nicely. So this is very strong evidence that plant-based diets lower your blood pressure. Well, looking at cancer incidence, again, pretty familiar story, very high prevalence across the board, but higher in African Americans, and not just the incidence, but when you look at mortality, again, higher mortality in African Americans, and this is, again, due to the way we choose to eat and live, so we've got to make some changes. Breast, prostate, pancreatic, and colon cancers have all been shown to be increased by diets that are high in fat and animal protein, and simultaneously low in grains, vegetables, and fruit. Diets that are high in saturated trans fat, red meat, and other types of animal protein are particularly problematic. These cancers strike African Americans to a disproportionate degree and with greater lethality. 5-year breast cancer survival rates for African American women are 69% compared to 84% for Caucasian women. African American men have a 60% higher incidence rate for prostate cancer than white men, and once we are diagnosed with prostate cancer, we are more than twice as likely to die from it relative to our Caucasian counterparts, and that's because the prostate cancers that hit black men tend to be more aggressive and tend to spread more quickly. Excuse me. Pancreatic cancer incidence rates for 2000 to 2004 were 27% and 40% higher in African men and women respectively compared to non-Hispanic white men and women, while the mortality rates were 29 and 38% higher. Given its lethality with cancer as with heart disease, an ounce of prevention is clearly worth a ton of hearing. So I gotta ask you something, you got milk?
Not here.
Because if you do, then you're gonna have some problems. Milk is a biochemical solution designed to stimulate rapid cell growth and activate the immune system of baby carrots. Because baby carrots are supposed to grow, they're born without an immune system, they need something to get this all revved up. Well, it should come as no surprise then that it's been linked to several types of cancer and autoimmune diseases in adult humans. Why is that? That's because as an adult human, your cells are not supposed to be dividing rapidly. You start in taking in this fluid that's going to stimulate them and make them start to grow rapidly. They have no choice but to turn cancerous. And if you overstimulate your immune system, your immune system is like, you know, your drunk brain who doesn't know how to act. It just starts attacking everything, including you. And so you want to stay away from this stuff. You know, earlier today, one of the speakers talked about how dairy foods increase mucus production. And, you know, to some people that may seem a little non-specific. Mucus. You know, what does that mean? Well, what you have to understand is that mucus is one of our body's primary means of interfacing with the world and preventing bad things from getting into your body. Your respiratory tract is lined with mucus so that if you breathe in bacteria or some other antigen or pollen or whatever, it gets caught in the mucus and coughed out or spat out. Your intestinal tract is lined with mucus that is chock full of antibodies and other compounds that kill bacteria, so that when bacteria come into your digestive system through your food, it gets caught up in the mucus, killed by the antibodies or the antibacterial compounds, and they don't get into your system and cause disease. So yes, milk does stimulate mucus production because it's supposed to. It's supposed to help that baby cow interface with the world and not get sick. But again, when you, with an already normally functioning immune system, start taking this stuff that makes it overreact, it's like, you know, giving your police department a bunch of meth. Let's just start acting a fool. Alright, well, I'm really proud of this little picture here because I designed it. It says, got lactose intolerance, and you see these individuals of color who are doubled over with cramps from drinking milk. 75% of individuals around the world are lactose intolerant, particularly people of color, and if you are lactose intolerant, you may have grounds for a lawsuit, one that we and PCRM filed against the dairy industry. Symptoms of lactose intolerance includes diarrhea, abdominal cramps, gas, bloating, and abdominal pain. And people in the dairy industry constantly said, oh, it's not that bad. You know, if you drink little bits of it at a time, you'll be okay. Male bovine fertilizer. I can tell you that I am profoundly lactose intolerant. And I have put out a message to the dairy industry. If you want to prove that it's not that bad, handcuff yourself to me and I'll drink all the milk that you want me to. You're going to suffer. For the majority of human beings worldwide, lactose intolerance is the norm. Within the United States, 95% of Asian Americans, 73% of blacks, 70% of Native Americans, and 53% of Hispanics are lactose intolerant. Many people of color suffering from lactose intolerance think that they have a problem with irritable bowel syndrome or spastic colon. I was seeing this in my clinic. These patients were coming in and said, oh, I got this disease. Take them off milk. The problem cleared up. And when I asked them, why were you continuing, and some of them would say, yeah, I know, it upsets my stomach, but I have to drink it. And I'm like, why? They're like, the dietary guidelines tell me that I have to drink this stuff. And that kind of pissed me off. Because essentially the government was pimping people of color to help the dairy industry make money. Yeah. When it was encouraging them to eat foods that it knew was going to make them ill, and from which they were not going to gain any appreciable benefit, because you do not need milk to get calcium. Cows don't drink milk, and they have plenty of calcium in their blood. Green leafy vegetables are full of calcium. You don't need calcium. And anyway, as I said, the symptoms can be severe, but they completely resolve once you come off dairy foods. Dairy foods have also been shown to exacerbate asthma, bronchitis, and chronic sinusitis. So, I'm going to switch gears a little bit here and propose this ghastly proposition to you. If you can read backwards, the sign says, do it yourself, which most people would not want to do. Humans do not like animal flesh in its unaltered native form. That is why we are compelled to change the way it looks, tastes, smells, in order to make it acceptable to us. How many of you have carnivore pets, I catch a dog. Has your pet ever sort of said to you, I'm not going to touch that until you fry it, bread it, and cover it with a peppercorn cheddar? I don't think so. Our manipulations of animal flesh are all designed to circumvent our disgust reflex. We try to make meat taste and smell like plants by cooking, seasoning, and marinating it in herbs, spices, and other plant products. You ever thought about that? We give it the texture of plants by bleeding, drying, cooking, and breading and frying it. And we make it look like plants by skinning, plucking, cutting, and shaping it into these little round, hand-sized objects that mimic fruit and other plant products, and then covering it with brightly colored sauces and garnishes. Studies have repeatedly shown that people like a crispy and crunchy mouthfeel, which is why you want to eat your cereal as soon as you put the almond milk on it and not let it get soggy. But these are clearly not the textures of raw animal flesh. The spices and herbs we use to flavor meat and fish are all plants, plant parts, or derived from plants. And in fact, we are trying to make the meat and fish taste like plants, which is what we really desire. The spice trade, of course, has been a major economic point of importance throughout human history and helps spur the age of exploration. It also turns out that only herbivores have a taste for and seek salt. Even when dying from sodium depletion, carnivores will not seek or even eat salt. How do we know this? Well, because back in the 50s, some rather cruel experiments were done. They took dog food, artificially depleted it of sodium, and took these dogs and fed them. They put out a bowl of dog food, and right next to it would be a little bowl of salt. And the dogs would dutifully eat their meal every day, but they would never touch the salt, and they eventually died from what's called hyponatremia, or too low sodium levels. And so carnivores have no internal mechanism to tell them to eat salt. Why is that? Well, if you've ever put your finger in your mouth when you're bleeding, you know that blood is full of salt. And if you're a carnivore, you're going to be eating other animals, so you're going to get plenty of salt. Plant tissues, on the other hand, are very low in salt. They're high in potassium, but low in salt. So if you're a plant eater, you have to have an internal mechanism that tells you, go out and find salt and eat it. And that's why we love potato chips. For humans, searching for salt has been a major pursuit for society. Throughout history, salt has been an important and prized commodity. Cities were often founded in places with natural salt formations. The word salary and soldier are from words that originally meant salt. And just to make the vegan connection, you know that Gandhi started his campaign against England by making salt. Salt. 1930. All right, well, this is from Carlton Dilbert. It says, Dogbert, I don't understand why you or anybody else would want to be a vegetarian. Dogbert says, you mean why don't I take dead animals, cook them until they become carcinogenic, and then eat them instead of something nutritious? Is that your question? He says, exactly. Is there any good reason? Have you joined a cult? He says, well, I do live in Loma Linda. And for those of you who may not get that connection, Loma Linda is where a lot of Seventh-day Adventists live. And the Seventh-day Adventist health study, which has been going on for over 20 years, has shown some amazing things. Shows that vegetarian Adventist men living in California live almost 10 years longer than non-Adventist men who eat meat. Vegetarian Adventist women also live 6.6 years longer than non-Adventist women who eat meat. Now, does that mean that being vegetarian is less beneficial for women than it is for men? No, it's just that, ladies, y'all live so much longer than we do, you have less room for improvement. Adventist vegetarians have lower risk of colon, breast, prostate, stomach, and kidney cancers. Lower risk of diabetes, heart disease, high blood pressure, and the metabolic syndrome, and high cholesterol, and a lower risk of all-cause mortality. So, in summary, we know that vegetarian diets are associated with a variety of health benefits, less heart disease, 50% reduction in all-cause cancer mortality, lower blood pressure, less osteoporosis, both before and after menopause, reduced risk of stroke, less obesity, less chronic diseases of all types, decreased incidence of both type 1 and type 2 diabetes, greater longevity, lower risk of Alzheimer's disease and other types of dementia, improved fertility, and lower risk for erectile dysfunction. Pay attention, guys. better immune system function, increased level of energy and greater functional capacity, higher levels of natural antioxidants, which reduces the impact of aging, a greater sense of well-being and a reduced risk of depression, and of course, a reduced impact on the planet. So with that, I just want to leave you guys with some thoughts from the talk. It's kind of an abridged version of this talk. It's called Having the Courage of Our Convictions, Lessons for the Vegan Vegetarian Movement from the Bible and the Struggle for Civil Rights. Now, this talk grew out of my trip to seeing the Martin Luther King Memorial in Washington, D.C. And if you haven't been there, I strongly encourage you to see it. It's a very, very moving memorial. And when I went there, I was very moved. In fact, I was moved to the point of tears because I was standing looking at a man who died at the age of 42. I was already older than he was when he died. And I thought about the fact that the medical school I went to did not accept its first black student until 1972. This is Stanford University, by the way, and it was founded in 1899. Didn't accept its first African American until 1972. Now, we didn't just get smart in 1972, but that was the result of the civil rights movement and the push to make this a more egalitarian and accessible society. And I thought about the fact that this man didn't live to be my age because he gave his life so that I could do the things that I've been able to do. And I was very, very moved by it. The way the memorial is constructed is, as you can see, there's this mountain and then this piece that comes forward, and the inscription on it says, "Out of the mountain of despair, a stone of hope." And I thought about everything that Dr. King and the other civil rights activists went through in their lives. Thought about Rosa Parks coming home from work one day, and she decided, you know what, I'm tired. I'm tired of putting up with this bullshit, and I'm not going to take it anymore. And she sat down. She took her seat on the bus. Now, when we look back 50 years hence, it all seems like it may have been somewhat preordained, that somehow Rosa Parks knew that sitting down on that bus was going to spark the Montgomery bus boycott and energize the civil rights movement. But she did not know that. She just knew that she was tired of putting up with things that were wrong. And so she said. And it wasn't just Rosa Parks. So there were a number of civil rights advocates who deserve mention. Here is Rosa Parks. So Merle Evers, the widow of Medgar Evers, who was killed for trying to get blacks to the right to vote in Mississippi. That was Cheney Schwerner and Goodman. The other lady was Fannie Lou Hamer. This was John Lewis. Can't remember this gentleman's name, but he was one of the Freedom Riders. These were three children from the Birmingham children's marches. And this is the end result of all of their efforts and sacrifice. But we also know that by the way the Republicans have treated this man, we still have a long way to go. But the point is that if you have the courage of your convictions, you can change the world. Now, when I became vegetarian back in 1974, stop doing the math, I'm not going to tell you how there was no such thing as Whole Foods or vegan options at the freaking supermarket. It's like, you know, there was one Whole Foods store in Oakland, and it sold organic peanut butter and homemade whole wheat bread, and that's what I survived on for quite some time. But things have changed, and they've changed in wonderful ways. But clearly, we still have a long way to go. Every holiday we go to spend with our families, we have to put up with the terrible traditions and the addictions of our family members. And it can be quite discouraging. I know some vegans who won't go home for the holidays because they are so put off and offended by what they see in their family members. But see, I think that that's wrong. Because I think that those family members need us. They need to see someone who says, you know what, I don't live this way, and I won't live this way, and I won't do this. It's very easy for us to hide ourselves away from the world or hang out with people who think like we do. But In so doing, we are doing a disservice to those around us. We have all been appointed by God as ambassadors of truth. We have been given this knowledge, not just for us, but for the rest of the world. And it is our job, it is our duty, it is our birthright to carry this message to people who don't understand it and who don't accept it. We know that, you know, everybody thinks that, you know, going to a fast food restaurant or going to Safeway and picking up, you know, their chicken is because some chicken was running around on a farm and happy and scratching in the grass, and then suddenly someone came and killed it. But that's not true. We know that this is all underwritten by the cruelty of factory farming, which, you know, by God's grace will someday be done away with. We know that when we try and talk to various people, that frequently we meet with resistance, you know, people make fun of us, and sometimes we meet with outright hostility. And again, it's tempted when we're confronted by this to shrink away, to go to places where we feel safe and accepted. But we can't do this because, as I said before, we have a job to do. And so I want to tell you just the story of Queen Esther. Esther was a princess, a Jewish princess, who was in the one of the queens of the Persian court. And during her time in Persia, this very hateful man named Haman had a law passed that said that on a certain day, all the people in the realm could kill Jews without fear of reprisal. And Esther's uncle, Mordecai, came to her and said, "You've got to do something. We can't let this happen because our entire our people will be destroyed." But there was a law in Persia that said if you went into the king's court without being summoned, you would be put to death. And Esther said, "You know, for me to go before the king without being summoned, is, you know, that's going to mean instant death." And Mordecai said to her, "Who knows whether thou art come to the kingdom for just such a time as this?" In other words, maybe the whole reason you were born is for this moment, because you are in a place where you can make a difference. So that's what I want you guys to remember. When you're at home and everybody's eating turkey and ham and whatever else they're eating, and it looks like, and you know, your cousin's making fun of you and nobody's listening, remember, you were brought into the world for just this moment. This is why you're here. You have a job to do, and don't be discouraged by the fact that people may not want to listen. So I'm going to leave you some inscriptions from the wall of the King Memorial. It says, "We shall overcome because the arc of the moral universe is long and it bends towards justice." And you have to remember that we are not alone in this fight because we have truth on our side. God is the author, repository, and champion of truth. This is his fight. We're really good soldiers working together with him to make this world a better place. It also says the ultimate measure of a man or person is not where he or she stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where we stand at times of challenge and controversy. It's easy to be vegan here because everything's vegan, everybody's vegan, and we all believe in what we're doing. But it's important to be vegan at work. It's important to be vegan at grandma's house. It's important to be vegan when people don't understand what you're doing and think you're crazy. That's when the true measure of our character comes in. He also says injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly, and that includes our non-human companions on this planet. And the last inscription says, "I believe that unarmed truth and unconditional love will have a final word in reality. That is why right, even temporarily defeated, is stronger than evil triumphant." So when we leave here tomorrow, let us go forth energized and renewed in our spirits, and committed to the job we have to do. Remember that when you're sitting in darkness and someone turns on the light, it hurts your eyes. And we may even close our eyes for a while till we get used to the light. Knowing this, then, we should not be dismayed when those around us don't immediately receive what we have to share with them with gladness. excuse me. It will take some time for change to come. So don't be discouraged by the flinty looks, the snarky comments, or even the outright hostility. We must learn to be patient, kind, and quietly persistent. Take your metaphorical seat on the bus. You may, be by yourself, but you are not alone. God is with you. We all are there with you, standing behind you, supporting you. So be strong, be sure, and be at peace. It is by embracing our role, the role that we have been given, that we become stones of hope for this troubled world. And we can all be stones of hope for a troubled world.